Thank you all the docents and gillies for staying. I know you had a long meeting this morning already, but we appreciate you spending a little extra time with us today. And thank you to all of our guests that have come today to listen to our great curator, Laura Fry. Laura came to us in December of 2015, so she's only been here two short years. One short years. Math, that's not my strong suit. Tacoma Art Museum in Washington. This is where she came from. She was a hub center of Western American art, where she spearheaded the inaugural exhibition and publication of the newly gifted Hobb Family Collection. Before that, she was the curatorial assistant at the Buffalo Bill Center of the West in Cody, Wyoming. So Laura originally comes from Cincinnati, Ohio. She has her BFA in ceramics, which that's what I have my MA in, so we're very bonded that way. From the Washington University, St. Louis, and she has an MA in art history and museum studies from University of Denver. Her research spans 19th and early 20th century American art, painters of the American West, design and architecture of the national parks, and women artists of the arts and crafts movement. So she knows a little bit about everything. She is currently working to expand recognition for the comprehensive American art collection at Gilcrease, developing a new interpretive plan, organizing exhibitions, assisting with plans for a major expansion and renovation of the museum. So you can see why we're so excited to have Laura with us here. Today she is going to give us a little insight on the beautiful collection, the exhibition Looking West, the Rumley Family Collection, and we're very excited to have the Rumley family with us here today. So please help me welcome Laura Fry.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for coming and giving up your lunch break to be here. And before I get started, of course, as Cindy mentioned, we're really thrilled to have Wayne and Andrea here as well, who generously have lent us this collection to have on display for the museum. Before I get started, I have a quick question. I'm wondering, is anybody here a collector? For not just for artwork, does anybody here collect, baseball cards or teapots, stamps, action figures? I'm seeing some nods, I'm seeing some hands raised. Definitely a collector here in the front row, as we know. But I'm wondering also, do you have your collection on display? For those of you who had their hands up, or is your collection out, do you have it in your home? Is it something that you have around you? Yeah. Yeah, several people. I'm hearing some laughs. Well, I think collecting is something that a lot of us participate in. It's whether it's artwork or salt and pepper shakers or any number of types of objects. And because we become passionate about these objects, we find interest in them for some reason or another. But it's something that a lot of humans find a connection with. And so as a curator, when considering a collector and a collection, I was wondering, how do I take all of this stuff from the Rumley Family Collection and create an exhibition? I had a few people ask me this during the opening for the Rumley Family Exhibition. They said, how did you do this? I said, well, I went to his office in the home and looked at some of the artwork, and they said, but how? And so I said, so today I'm hoping to pull back the curtain a little bit and to show a little bit about this process, how we went from the initial idea to this polished exhibition that you now see on view in our Getty Gallery. And really, that very first step for creating an exhibition in a museum, first step is that idea. It's a spark, or maybe it's an object. Maybe it's a particular work of art or historic object that is the idea for the exhibition, or maybe it's a person. Maybe it's a historic figure. Maybe it's a collector that you're basing an exhibition around. In this case, we have Wayne, of course, and Wayne, who is the patriarch for the Rumley family and is really the driving force behind the Rumley Family Collection. And a year ago, there really wasn't any thought of this exhibition. I had just started here at the Gilcrease, was just getting to know the ropes. And I remember having a conversation with our director, James Pepper Henry, and our development director, Frank. And we were talking about ways we might honor our longtime supporter and former board member, Wayne Rumley. And we came up with this idea to do an exhibition based on the Rumley Family Collection. And at that point, I really didn't know much about this collection. I had heard a little bit about it, I'd heard some good things, but I'd never seen any of the collection, so I was definitely taking a little bit of this on faith and saying, okay, I've heard some good things, I think we can make this work, let's go for it. So the next step was the initial research. So we met Wayne here at the museum, and we proposed doing this idea of doing an exhibition from the Rumley Family Collection, and he seemed pretty excited about that. So we arranged to go out and visit the R&R engineering office, his office. So that was our initial research, and you know, that initial step can be lots of things. Maybe it's a site visit like we did for the Rumley Family Collection. Maybe it's going to a library or browsing a database or simply calling up one of my museum colleagues on the phone to get some ideas started. I will say this is one of the best perks of working with museum collections. Whether you're a curator or a collections manager or an exhibit designer or conservator, we get to go to some really cool places. I've been to the back vaults and underground tunnels in museums all over the country, and to the floor of Sotheby's auction in New York, and got to see some of their behind the scenes, out to ranches in the middle of Wyoming, to artist studios, to an antique frame restoration studio, so just these really amazing places. And I will say that visiting the Rumley, the offices, the R&R offices, was right up there in terms of amazing places I have visited while being a curator. So the building's in Broken Arrow, and it's in a very distinctive style. You definitely say it's a Pueblo revival, perhaps, or a Spanish revival. It's a stucco building, and when you're inside, you might as well be walking down a sidewalk in Santa Fe. There's tile floors, stucco walls, lots of cast iron. There are these cast iron lanterns that are hanging low and really giving this ambiance. So it's this really unique place. And first, we toured through, and I'll never forget this first visit. And this is the first time I'd had a chance to see any of this collection. So we went through and we saw some of the amazing two-dimensional works, the paintings, in this collection. And we said, okay, there's some really beautiful paintings here. I think this is going to be a great exhibition. Kept going, there's cases full of spurs. And there's cases of pottery and silversmithing. There's all these different collections around the place. And so we're saying, yeah, there's some again, really, really interesting things. And then Wayne shows us the baskets. So we go into a side room, and I think all of us were sort of stunned for a couple of minutes. And just looking at these, and I'm not an expert in Native American baskets. You didn't have to be. These were such beautiful objects. They drew us in immediately, and were absolutely stunning. The geometry, sort of the mathematical precision, the design, the craftsmanship, these were absolutely beautiful objects. And we said, okay, this is going to be a really fabulous exhibition. And then Wayne took us to show us the rugs. There was a stack of Navajo textiles, I kid you not, about 18 inches tall, about here, laid out flat on the floor. And as you can see the person's arm, you can see on the couch there, you can see how big these are. And of course, some of them are in the exhibition, so you can really see the size. And we're kneeling on the floor, and Wayne said, well, just, you know, start pulling them back so you can see the next one. And each one was better than the one before it. It was absolutely magical to go through this stack of objects, and they were so beautiful. And so the colors were so vibrant, and some of these rugs were new and had been done in the last 10 years, and some of them were 120 years old, and everything in between. So at this point, it was really clear to me that the difficult part about organizing this exhibition would be narrowing it down to what we could actually fit. So we were really excited after this first visit. We said, this is a great idea. This show is going to be fabulous. Whatever direction we take, I think this is going to work. And so then we came to the next step. that's developing that main idea. Now we had a sense for what's in the collection, we've got this initial concept, but what's the thesis? What's the main theme? What's the storyline? And this is where being a curator in a museum is a little different than maybe how the word curated is kind of used in popular culture right now. You often hear people say, oh, you know, they curate their blog, or they curate their Facebook photographs or something, and which is fine and good, but it's very different than what we do in museums. And I even pulled up this curating. This is an article from a satirical Australian newspaper, came out about 6 months ago, but they say curating is the same as choosing, and that a person who curates fashion, music, food, or travel experience is actually just choosing things, it has been confirmed. And the article continues to say, a study has found that there is absolutely no need to use the word curate outside a museum. And I think it's fine that, of course, that this word is now used in many ways in pop culture. But the difference, and what we're doing in a museum, is not just choosing stuff based on our personal taste or preference. That's what you do in your house, perhaps. When you're decorating your home, you put up things that you like. That's what we all do. But in a museum, we have to consider various audiences being served and how these objects work together to tell a larger story. That's the difference. And so if perhaps for me, if it was just my personal preference, all of these objects are beautiful, but I really loved the Navajo rug. So I would have done like an entire show of all rugs. And you know, maybe we'll ask about doing that in the future at some point. But for this particular exhibition, that wasn't the main goal. We really wanted to show the full scope and get a broader look at the Rumley Family Collection. And I was also interested in seeing how these objects operated together. So we have a lot of different types of objects made across about almost a 200-year time span by many different cultures, many different media. And so how do you connect all this together? And so for my main idea, after really considering all, going back through photographs and remembering the visit, I wanted to show that communities of artists in the West have helped shape a sense of place. That's what united these. They all had a sense of place in the American West and helped define how we, even today, we perceive this region. And so the idea was that these objects maintain this sense of place by merging the past with the present and bringing new technologies to longstanding traditions and new techniques. And so it was a way to tie together these works from very different areas. So now that we had the main idea and the main thesis, it's time to create the exhibition checklist. So this means going over the floor plan for the gallery, getting out my tape measure, kneeling down on the floor, measuring some of the spaces, seeing how many objects we can fit in each area, going through our super sophisticated foam core model of the Getty Gallery, nothing but high tech for a Gilcrease Museum. Yep. It works, it's like very simple, but it works. And it was also taking into consideration, you know, do we want this exhibit to be really dense and salon style? Do we want it to be more open and to have a lot of breathing room and to give each individual item some space? So you can go either way, there's different design philosophies. And this also required going back to the office. I will say that Wayne and his son Warren were really generous with their time because we had to keep going back and going back and going back to continue planning this exhibition. Of course, on one of these visits, we brought one of our conservators to help assess the condition of some of these works and if they're sturdy enough for display, and went through and re-photographed things, created a checklist, assigned numbers. So again, we've got our super sophisticated system of holding a post-it note there with a number on it and photograph. But it works. Again, at the end of this, we had a final checklist. We knew how many objects we were going to include, and we were ready for the next steps, which was bring me an education. What kind of education elements do we want in the space? Now we have the main idea. We've got that we know what objects we're bringing in. Now how can we help present this to the public and present this to the public in multiple ways? Not just words on the wall, Can we provide something that people can create, can make, can help learn about these techniques and these objects by actually handling similar items? And so our education director, Cindy, had this marvelous idea to create this large basket form that our visitors can weave different materials into to kind of to get a little sense for some of the weaving techniques used on the objects in the collection. And then it also becomes kind of a community art project because every visitor can have a chance to add to it. There's also a lot of writing. If you have anyone, if you've ever spoken with a young person who's thinking about going into the museum field or into humanities, tell them to take writing classes. It's something that we do quite a lot, and of course, so that all these wonderful text panels and labels in the museums have to come from somewhere, and that somewhere is, and so that's a big part of the process is condensing down these ideas to pithy, short, you know, hopefully, but interesting, and writing that will draw in our visitors. And this goes through an editing process too, so then it goes back to education, back to our communications manager. Of course, there's the shipping. So we sent a whole, we did it in a couple different trips, but sent our team of preparators to pick up the items from the Rumley collection, and this was a fairly easy compared to some of the shipping we do because it was right here in Broken Arrow, but still, of course, they had a whole truck full of supplies to do all the packaging and to treat these objects as carefully as possible to get them back here to the museum. And then the exhibit preparation. Once we have everything here, they're not all ready to put on display right away. For example, one of the things we did with all of the Navajo textiles is we froze them. We have a, our conservation department has a super high powered freezer that can go down to like minus 70 degrees. And in about a 2-day time span, if the objects are placed in this freezer, it will kill any, if there's any pest activity or any eggs anywhere on an object, it will completely kill off any potential pests. And anybody's home, even here in the museum, we occasionally have pest issues, especially here in Oklahoma. And so a wool being something that's really attractive, we thought that would be a great way to make sure that everything was clean and ready to be put out in the galleries. So we froze all the rugs. And then we started also a lot of the ceramics and baskets in the show needed mounts. If we just left them flat on a pedestal, it'd be really difficult to see. So we had our mount builder, who's also a sculptor, who has really fine hand skills. He uses jewelry tools to build these, but we did custom brass mounts for several objects that are in the cases upstairs, so we had to do this step. And of course, all those rugs are up on the wall. Well, that involved having each rug has a hand-stitched strip of Velcro sewed to the back of it by one of our conservation assistants, Sarah. So she hand-stitched all of these to the back of each rug that's on display, and then we mount them to the wall with another strip of the opposing side of Velcro. So it involves a lot of people. It's fairly time-consuming, and so to have all of these steps go through before we can even begin installing the exhibition. We also thought it was great how much larger the rug was than Sarah, so we had to take this picture. So finally, we've got everything in the building. We have the writing done. We've got the education components. We've prepared everything. We've got the mounts. And we are ready to install. Now is the fun part. And as we were putting together this installation, I was working with our exhibit designer, Patrick, and for a space like this, I really try and think about what are the viewpoints somebody experiences as they walk through the space? What catches them and draws them into the gallery? So I really adored this particular textile, but it was kind of a tricky one because the color scheme is completely different from anything else that we included in the exhibition. Instead of having reds and navy and tan, it has green and orange and yellow. And so when we tried to hang it near some of the other rugs, it really kind of clashed. They didn't go well. So a good solution was actually putting it on the title wall where it had its own space. And it's also really bright and vivid, so we were just really thrilled to come up with that as our title piece. Then as you walk through the space, I was looking to have the architecture kind of frame the next viewpoint, so you then have that next red rug, that pop of color that draws you into the next room. Likewise, you know, coming around the corner, using the architecture as an additional framing for some of these pieces. So you still, so you have these works really, even if you don't read a single label and you just walk through the space, I'm hoping that the architecture and the way the works are arranged can help to tell a story all by themselves. Because each visitor is generally looking for a slightly different way of experiencing an exhibition. And then having a really interesting object in the middle of a room will also draw people in and help kind of with that flow back and forth. Like this wonderful horn chair, I think, is a good way to kind of invite you into this space. And it's always good to end on a strong note. So there's this beautiful final Navajo textile on your way out at the end of the exhibition. But what if somebody goes the other direction? So that's something to consider too. If they go the other way through the galleries, what's that experience? Do they have something pulling them in? Do they have a good, is there a good flow? Does it make visual sense? So here we've got this beautiful wall of Frank McCarthy paintings. And then as you come around this corner, you've got this red rug again pulling you into that space, framed in that in the architecture. And then opening up to the exhibition. So it's fun, for me it's like, no matter if you turn around or whichever direction you're going, do you have a good, like, is the visual arrangement work? Do you have a nice composition in front of you with all of these groups of objects? And so it was a thrill to get this out and open, and I think it was really rewarding for all of our staff to finally see the finished product. We had so many people in this building working on the exhibition at some point in the process. So we are just really thrilled to bring this out. And next I want to talk a little bit about some of the objects themselves and some of the relationships between them, because of course these are very different types of objects, different materials, but they have a lot to say to one another. And so among the really wonderful objects in this exhibition are the baskets. And most of these baskets, they're from a huge geographic region. Some of them are from Arizona or New Mexico, all the way up through California, the Pacific Northwest, and Alaska. So they represent a huge geographic area and many different cultures. But what they have in common is their impeccable craftsmanship. Most of these baskets were made in the late 19th century, right around 1890, 1900, 1910, somewhere in there. And it was right at that period that there were new trading posts opening in the Western United States, in the Southwest, in Seattle. And these trading posts were giving Native artists an opportunity to find a new market for their work. Most of these baskets were made by women. And it was a way that women could support their families, especially as life was rapidly changing for many Native Americans in that era. Turning to the arts became an important source of income. And many of these objects were based on forms that had been utilitarian, made for everyday storage or cooking or for other purposes, but they took these utilitarian forms and started really making artworks that were based on these utilitarian forms. So if you had this basket, I don't think you'd just use it for storage. I think you would maybe put this, even if you purchased this in the 1890s, you would probably put it somewhere very prominent, on a mantle, on a table in the middle of a room, and use it to decorate your home and as an art object. I love the upside down deer on the lid. Just, it's so beautiful. And this is from the Pitt River in California. And I also had quite a lot of help on the baskets. Like I said, I'm not a basket expert. It's been a great learning process. But one of the experts who had worked with Wayne to help build his collection was a great help to me. She helped provide many of the cultures and the dates for these works. Here are a couple others. These are the one, I really love the humor in some of these. This is a rattlesnake with a rabbit. So there's some kind of narrative there. I don't know if the rattlesnake's about to pounce or if he just got the rabbit. Now the rabbit's, you know, on its side. But it's really definitely a lighthearted note, a humorous note. And that's a basket from the Palm Springs area from, again, the early 20th century. So I encourage you to look for it. And there are many of the baskets do have small animals or human figures included somewhere in the design. Like this one, which is a pomo basket from Northern California. And this has these beautiful human figures around the edge, but also this beautiful, beautiful feather motif around the top of the shoulder of the basket. And these are quail topknots. So if you think of a quail, like that little feather coming out of their head, that's what these are. And another thing I'll say for the baskets in the Rumley Family Collection, they're in perfect condition. I mean, this is a 120-year-old object. You can imagine how delicate those feathers are. and it's just in superb condition. So it's a really a rare chance to see some of these objects like they were almost made yesterday. So really take a close look at the details of these baskets. An interesting thing about the baskets and some of the Navajo textiles, like this rug, honestly, when I first saw this in Wayne's office, I thought it was a new rug. It's from the 1890s. It's got a really fine weave. One of the things I really love about it is if you look at it closely, you can see a little bit in the photograph, but the yarn dye kind of changes. Here we go. You can see the changes across the rug, so you get some blue streaks, you get some slightly lighter purple streaks, but it makes it very clear that this is a handmade object. It's not mass-produced. It's not coming from a factory. And many of these brilliant colors, it's dark purple and red, that was actually from yarns that were newly available to the Southwest in the 1890s as the railroad system expanded, but they used yarns that were produced in Germantown, Pennsylvania, with new commercial dyes and chemical and aniline dyes that were much more vivid than the vegetable-based dyes or the natural sheep colors that the Navajo had used previously. So many of these are referred to as Germantown rugs after Germantown, Pennsylvania. So I mean, these objects are national. They really are pulling materials from many different places. And again, most of these rugs, especially at this time period, were made by women. And it's interesting to me that in the 1890s, female Native artists are really coming into their own and really creating these works as artworks, not just as utilitarian items or as blankets, because it's the same era that women in the eastern United States, women of all different backgrounds, were really beginning to use the arts as a way to pursue a professional career and making a statement about the fact that arts made by women could be fine art, could be high art. In Western culture with a lowercase w, is Europe and the United States, there's been a historic distinction starting in about the Renaissance between low art, which is utilitarian, it's things made out of ceramic or wood or silversmithing, and high art, which is painting and sculpture, think like Michelangelo, Leonardo da Vinci, that was high art as opposed to low art. And they drew this really hard line in the sand between these two types of ways of thinking about how creative objects and artisans and artists. That doesn't really exist in the rest of the world, that distinction. And I think beginning in about this era in the 1890s with the American Arts and Crafts Movement, there was a drive to start erasing that distinction and to say that an object, even if it was made out of ceramic or wool or fibers like the basket, could be considered a high art object, equal in value, equal in to having the same cultural value as something made with oil paint on canvas. Part of my motivation for showing these rugs on the wall was to present them in the same way that we see paintings. In our galleries here at the Gilcrease, we've got, you know, a Bierstadt painting that's the same size as this rug. And if I'd shown the rug on the floor, it would have given it kind of a different status. And I wanted these to be shown as full artworks, equal in merit to the many beautiful paintings that we have here in the Gilcrease Museum. So at about the same time those rugs and baskets are being made, you also have artists like Thomas Moran traveling around the American West. You also have the Tao Society of Artists starting to move to New Mexico in the early 20th century. This watercolor I absolutely adore. It's very beautiful. Can you see the people? Why do you think he made them so small? He's showing a scale. He could have put the people a lot closer to the viewer in the composition so they were larger and more easier to see. But instead, the people are tiny. They're all the way back here. There we go. All the way back here. And what they show you is that these natural features in Yellowstone Park are immense. They dwarf people. He's showing us that, you know, maybe we're ultimately rather powerless against the forces of nature. And by showing these tiny people, he also gives someone who'd never traveled west of the Mississippi River a sense for the grandeur of the American West and of Yellowstone's features. And so at the same time, Moran is doing these watercolors, and he, of course, lived and worked in the East, and he was from Pennsylvania, but then had a studio in Long Island. But collectors from the East are also purchasing Navajo rugs, purchasing Native American baskets to decorate their homes and to use in their homes. It was also part of, in the American Arts and Crafts Movement, there was a drive to turn to American styles, to distinct American design. What could possibly be more American than work by indigenous artists? So that was a big part of the motivation for collecting those works. And then you get to about 50 years later, 56 years later, to the mid-20th century. And there's a group of artists that's really well represented in the Rumley Family Collection, known as the Cowboy Artists of America. And is anybody familiar with this group? At least a couple people. Well, they were founded in 1865. It was a group of four of them got together in Sedona, Arizona, and went to a bar and said, okay, I think we have to found a group of painters that is going to be following the precedent of Frederick Remington and Charlie Russell. And they considered themselves rebels because they weren't following the mainstream art that was really prevalent at that point in the 1960s. They didn't like abstract art. They didn't like what was going on in New York. And Charlie Dye, this is pretty funny. I mean, they considered themselves, like again, not following the mainstream. They're doing their own thing. He said he didn't want to be, quote, a whore in black stockings like some of those big painters. You know, he's like making fun of her. I do think it's kind of funny because for how much they really wanted to emulate Frederick Remington, he lived in New York and showed in New York. So they're maybe taking some ideas from Remington and Russell, but maybe not following them all the way through. And the imagery is really interesting. It really is mimicking Remington and Russell. It's taking that that concept and reinforcing it. And this group is still going strong today. They were founded in 1965. They still exist. They keep getting new members. They do, for a while, I think they might still do, but they did an annual trail ride just to really be authentic to the West and to this cowboy idea. And I do think it's interesting because many of them don't depict what cowboys look like today. They try and show this sort of perfect image of the past, this very idealized image of what might have happened earlier. And again, this is by Tom Ryan. These are these two cowboy figures. They're really heroic. They've got sunglasses on, like they're cool. They look like movie stars. He's even got like this glowing kind of a golden light behind him. I mean, he's one of these guys. These guys look like heroes. The title for this work, I think some of you who are docents here will appreciate. It's called "Coming Through the Dry." Which of course is a play on words for a Frederick Remington sculpture, "Coming Through the Rye." These artists certainly have a good sense of humor, I think. But then some of the artists who are involved with the Cowboy Artists of America also look at some of the darker past of the American West and some of the tragedy of the past. This work by Howard Terpening is Chief Joseph's Ride to Surrender. So here he's showing Chief Joseph on the horse surrounded by several of his companions from the Nez Perce tribe as they surrendered to the U.S. Cavalry in, I think, 1877. The tribe was really fleeing the cavalry to try to avoid being confined to a reservation, to simply stay in their home. I mean, this is something that any of us can relate to. And Howard Terpening certainly captures the pathos. It's exaggerated. Their expressions are really, really emphasized. Joseph, I mean, so I wonder if in reality if they might have been a little more stoic, but we don't know, none of us were there. And what he's capturing here is really the emotion that must have been going through these people and the Nez Perce as this event was taking place. But it's not just about the Nez Perce. There might be some, even I know this used to be on display at the Gilcrease, as I understand, for a while. But this composition actually has a much older root. It's really based on, there was a whole medieval and Renaissance tradition of images of Christ entering Jerusalem on a donkey surrounded by his disciples. This image is by the Italian painter Giotto from 1305 from the Scrovegni Chapel in Padova. So it's an image that was repeated in Christian iconography time and time and time again. Of course, Chief Joseph was not Christian, but he's... Howard Terpening might be referencing this very known type of imagery that's been part of Western culture, again, Little Western, for centuries, and using that pathos. Of course, when in this event in the Gospels, Christ is going to his crucifixion. And so what do you think Howard Terpening is telling us about Chief Joseph? He's saying he really admires Chief Joseph. And saying that perhaps that he's a figure to be admired and really someone who is standing up for his convictions, and perhaps Christ-like. So there's a lot of interesting threads in these images. There really is. And about the same time period as the Cowboy Artists of America was getting going, you of course had new innovations happening with indigenous artists all over the American West. This pictorial Navajo textile is by Shirley Johns from about 1975. So it's about the same time period. And I really, if you haven't had a chance to yet in the galleries, I encourage you to stop and take a close look at this painting, because you will keep finding amazing details embedded in this work, such as the sky. Can anybody see the... Yeah, we've got a little fighter jet right here, and maybe a commercial plane, and there's a third one right here. Yep, so not just one, but three airplanes in the sky. There's a pickup truck right here. But then there's also a dance taking place in the middle. So, and then there's covered wagons and sheep. There's a sheep herd at the bottom. And then maybe, you know, some hogans, so very traditional dwelling structures. So this textile, this pictorial, is showing how continuity of cultures, but also changes and updates in modernity, and the fact that we're all experiencing modernity, and they're doing that in this very, you know, traditional format of a Navajo textile, but by bringing in the airplanes and the pickup trucks, and it's showing that these cultures aren't static, that they're continuing to change, and that this modern world is also where the Navajo exist. And it's just, the humor is really fun. I love the airplanes. I come from a family of pilots. Maybe that's why I was drawn to this one. But I think it's a really interesting look at that culture at that point. And so coming into today and into artists that are still alive and still working, there's also many artists in this collection that are contemporary. And one of the things I really love about some of the contemporary works in the Rumley Family Collection is the impeccable detail. I mean, all of these works are beautifully detailed from all these different time periods, but this Acoma vase, it is just staggering. When I flipped it over to read the name of the artist, I almost had to get a magnifying glass, and I have 20/20 vision. It was so tiny and so precise. And I wish we could let visitors hold this vase. It's obviously not quite safe enough for the object, but it is feather light. It's ceramic. It's a coil built ceramic vessel, but it is almost like porcelain. It's so finely made. It weighs almost nothing. I mean, I was almost scared just moving it, but holding it in your hands, it's this perfect shape that it really fits in your hands. And so holding it and feeling that weight is almost part of the experience of the object. Unfortunately, for practical reasons, that's not really possible, and I certainly wouldn't want to have any risk come to this piece. But the weight of it and the craftsmanship of the coil building is just as precise as the painting on the surface and the slip painting. So this one is absolutely spectacular.
What is that
one? Acoma Pueblo.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Laura,
yes.
Is that artist well known in that field?
It was difficult to tell for, so I did have names for several of the Native artists, that was actually a couple that did that one. I'd have to look up the name. It was difficult to find, especially with a short turnaround time for this exhibition, it was difficult to really to find much information about a lot of the artists. Oftentimes artists like this, they're represented by a gallery. You can usually find a little bio on a gallery website, or maybe in a catalog, but it was really on the short time span. These artists were often very difficult to track down. So I don't know too much about them, other than this work was definitely very recent. Wayne is actually probably the really good source if you'd like to know about, because I know he knows many of these artists. So if you'd like to know about the artists, I would suggest asking Wayne. He'd be the best source. And this one's a beautiful Ganado rug. It actually won a first prize. The year was, I think, 1997 is the year this was made. And again, it's taking that traditional idea of the textiles that was really pushed forward, and taking this idea that was over 100 years old and pumping it up a couple notches. And so this rug just has really intricate detail, these almost kind of eye-dazzling designs. And it's taking that initial concept and seeing how far can you push that? Can you go bigger? Can you increase the detail? Can you really take this form of art that's been around for over a century and continue to make it new? And that's something that painters are doing today as well. I think artists working in any of these media Here we have two paintings that are, again, at first seem pretty closely related to the Cowboy Artists of America. Okay, we've got a cowboy and a cowgirl. These are Western themes. These are Western archetypes. But if you look a little closer, there's more going on here. This painting, instead of celebrating a cowboy, it's of course celebrating a cowgirl. And it's showing she's now the icon. She's got this, you know, beautiful sky behind her. She's backlit. She's really powerful and still very feminine. And so it's showing that this idea of a classic Westerner isn't always the guys. Women are also a big part of the West, even though in Hollywood or in the way the West was historically portrayed, even by people like Remington, there weren't that many women in the imagery, but they were here, and they were in the West for certain. And this painting, and these are both paintings. I know they look like photographs. These are both paintings. They are absolutely, really, again, I encourage you to look at them very closely when you're in the galleries. And this painting, again, it's your cowboy. We know this guy. He's in advertising. He's in movies. Like, we've seen this cowboy before. Very traditional. But then look at what's behind him. You notice what's on the barn wall? It's graffiti. So instead of just showing an artist, a cowboy in the West, it's showing that maybe his concept of the West, there's this new generation coming in, or maybe his concept of the West, there's this intrusion of the modern world, and maybe even a little bit of protest against, you know, this old barn wall. So he's still maintaining this idea of being a traditional cowboy, but in a new setting, and in this setting that's starting to have modern elements creep into it. So it's like, what is the traditional West, and like, how does that look today? So I encourage you, of course, to take a close look at the exhibition. Of course, now that we've also had a chance to hear a few more details, please go and spend some more time with these objects. You'll find new details every time I walk through. They're just absolutely spectacular works of art. And of course, I remember. This rug was a particular favorite for the staff. I even had a couple of our exhibit preparators who are artists themselves couldn't get over how much they loved this one. So you know when artists are really admiring the collection that it's truly a strong group of works. This was one that Wayne specifically requested we include in the show. He was very generous on giving us a lot of creative freedom to pick and choose from his collection and to live without these items for a few months. But when he asked if this one could be included, I said, okay, twist my arm. This is a spectacular piece. I said, absolutely. We will include this one on the show, and so we're thrilled to have this and all of the works here at the Gilcrease Museum. And also, of course, please give your thanks to Wayne. Let's give him a round of applause for Wayne for lending this exhibition.